So if you found yourself wanting to throw your keep key in the bin, trying to work through the ShapeShift setup process for it, I've put together a video that is just for you. Perhaps one of the biggest challenges with the keep key is the company that makes it and distributes it now run an exchange platform called ShapeShift. So just about everything about the keep key now wants you to direct you towards that platform. But unfortunately, the ShapeShift platform isn't really out of beta yet. And I really, really found it to be lacking in a lot of ways. Fortunately, you don't have to use it, and this video looks at how you're going to do that. And if you haven't already done so, hit subscribe, and that way you can stay in the loop about content I make to help you stay safe in a crazy and often hostile environment that is cryptocurrency. So I was doing a video on getting started with a keep key, and just thought I'd throw together a separate video that looks at what I would suggest to be my recommended way to get it set up and running, and specifically looks at how to initialize your keep key using Electrum. Because that allows you to use a full 24-word seed and allows you to also use some of the more advanced features that are supported by this that simply are not supported at all by the ShapeShift platform at this time. So this guide will be using Electrum, which is an open source Bitcoin wallet. But the thing is that even if you're not planning to store Bitcoin on your Keepkey, Electrum is still a great tool to securely initialize the wallet. So as much as I find the default Keepkey workflow, if you follow their getting started instructions, to be a complete disaster, it's still a very capable hardware wallet if you do things slightly differently. So you want to follow the getting started guide, totally skip step one, totally skip step two, and you want to update your device. So let's download the updater app. That's this one here. You need that to put the firmware on your device. You can close this tab. We don't need their instructions anymore. Step three is you want to download Electrum. So you want to make sure you download Electrum from electrum.org. And I've actually got a video that looks at how to verify the download of Electrum to make sure that what you're downloading is authentic. So when you run Electrum for the first time, you'll be presented with this screen here, and you can just say auto connect unless you're running your own Electrum server, which is way beyond the scope of this video. And what it's going to ask you to do is to create a new wallet. So we're just going to say next, because the name of this doesn't matter. We just want to initialize the device. Now, we're going to say we want a standard wallet. And we're going to say we have a hardware device. And if you haven't run it as an administrator, you'll actually notice that it won't find your Keepkey no matter what you do. And that's actually a current issue that's been introduced by the latest versions of Windows, and they'll probably get remedied in future versions of Electrum. But if you just run Electrum as an administrator, it'll actually find your keep key without a problem. So once we've found our hardware key store, we're going to say next. And so what we want to select is this first option here, let the device generate a completely new seed randomly. So we're going to say next. And we want a full 24-word seed. We don't want a 12-word seed, we want a 24-word seed. I think it's fair to say that a 12-word seed isn't insecure, but if your device supports a 24-word seed, it is just as easy to generate, to store, and to use a 24-word seed, and it is significantly more secure, not just today, but also into the future. We'll give the device a name, we'll enable PIN protection, and say next. Now, if we look on the screen, it's going to show us the internal entropy of the device that we can check. That looks good. So we'll just click through. And now we're assigning a PIN. So this is the same as before, in that we just type in the PIN here. The numbers on these boxes correspond to what's on the device. So for the purpose of this video, we're just going to say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Again, recommending you go with a nice long pin, not something short. And if you forget the pin, you can always just reset the device using your seed phrase. It's not a problem. Now, this is the same as before, except this time we actually have two screens worth of words. So you can actually download a template for recovery sheets for like a Ledger Nano or anything else like that that has space for the full 24 words. I definitely recommend using something like this, or at least numbering the words rather than just scribbling them out on a page in any random order, because you cannot rely on your ability to remember. If you're looking to store your seed phrase in something a bit more robust than a piece of paper, there are a few products that do that. You can get a cold tie, which is essentially a sheet of metal that you just stamp it into, or you can get a crypto steel, which basically comes with everything you need to essentially put it together like a puzzle, which just has the first four letters of each word in your phrase, which is all you need. There's also a newer option called a Kobo wallet, which is basically priced in between the two. And if you want to help me out in the process for either of those, I've got an affiliate link in the description. So basically, you need to write down the words I've actually printed the recovery sheet nice and big as well, because it doesn't have to be small. You would then write down the first 12 words, and only once you've double checked that they're all correct, you can say next, and then you can write down the second 12 words. And once you have done that, you have a recovery sheet that has the full 24 words that you can secure somewhere, and you now have your device initialized with a full 24 word seed. And now we create our wallet type. If you're just starting out and just new to crypto, this middle option is probably the best one. That'll give you addresses that start with a 3, which are very compatible across a range of different wallets. And we're going to say we want to encrypt the wallet file, and I'll show you why in a sec. See, now that we've got this default wallet and we've encrypted it, unless you have the Keepkey connected with the correct seed on there, you're not going to be able to actually open this wallet file at all. That's going to be really useful in terms of verifying the recovery seed using Electrum. So before putting any funds onto the wallet, we're also going to verify that the recovery seed you've got is correct. And just for the sake of completeness, we're going to do this using Electrum. And it's also a good way to just familiarize yourself with the process of restoring a wallet seed onto your Keepkey. Just a quick warning for those who might be watching this video but already actually have funds on their Keepkey. You want to make sure that if there are already funds on your Keepkey that you can do that without wiping the device. And I cover that in my previous video on setting up the Keepkey. So we're going to click on this little Keepkey icon down there, and we're just going to go in to the Advanced tab and wipe the device. It'll ask us to confirm that on the Keepkey itself, and we can just press the button and it will wipe it clean. So once we've wiped the device, what we're going to want to do is say File, New, create a new wallet file, one of the standard wallet, hardware device, and we basically run through the process again. But this time we're going to say, I want to recover from a seed I've previously written down. We give the device a name. So we set the pin, so we'll just get a nice long one. All right, so what's going to happen now is we're going to have the same thing that we saw on the 12-word recovery, in that we have a cipher here where the letters correspond in the gray to what the letter says on the card on the top row. And as we type those words in, we can accept a word, and we can restore all 24 words that way. Now that we've reset the device, we're just going to run Electrum, and it's going to prompt us and says this file is encrypted using a hardware device. That's what we want. We say next. We'll see our device show up there. We say next. Now we type in our PIN. And if we restore the device correctly and have the same seed on, it will open the wallet. If, however, the seed we've restored is different, or we've made some other mistake restoring it and somehow still got a valid seed, it'll actually say fail to decrypt device. If you're an advanced user, you can enable a BIP39 passphrase. That provides a lot of extra protection in case someone gets their hands on a recovery sheet, but it also does make it a lot easier to straight up lose your funds if you forget your BIP39 passphrase, have some typos in it that you didn't realize or something like that. Just recently, there was a security disclosure from the team at Kraken. They offered quite detailed instructions on how you'd go about doing key extraction on the device, and because of that, ShapeShift have now issued a bit of a best practice reminder to essentially recommend that people use a BIP39 passphrase. That means that if someone gets their hands physically on your Keepkey, even if they do manage to do a key extraction attack, they actually can't get your crypto. So I'll just run through how to do that quickly now. So I have another video that looks at how to select a good BIP39 passphrase, and I'll just link to that here in the top corner. But once you've selected a BIP39 passphrase, you can actually easily just turn it on using Electrum. So basically, you just click in the little plugin in the bottom right corner. You can just say Settings, Advanced, and you can say Enable Passphrases. And it gives you a warning here saying that. Because the thing with these BIP39 passphrases is that there's no error checking on them. Every passphrase you enter is technically valid. And every single one gives you a completely different wallet, so a completely different set of addresses. So we'll say yes, and we'll confirm that action on the device. But the thing is that the normal wallet that you would see without having a BIP39 passphrase is actually exactly the same wallet that you see if you just enter a blank BIP39 passphrase. So I'll just show you what that looks like. So So once you've got a BIP39 passphrase enabled, after you type in your PIN, you'll be prompted to enter a passphrase. So just for this first demo, we'll just leave the passphrase blank, and you'll see that it'll actually happily reopen the previous wallet that we had. So what we're going to do now is we're going to create a wallet with a passphrase that we want to use. And then we just create a new wallet file. We have to give it a different name to this old one. And what we are going to do is say standard wallet. Then we're going to say we have a hardware device. Now, the thing you'll notice is it will never discover your Keepkey while you still have another window open that is using your Keepkey. And in this case, that is Electrum that's using it. So we're going to close this previous wallet that we had. And then we're going to say next. And we'll find the Keepkey. Now, we're going to type in the PIN. Okay, so this passphrase we're going to type in here is the passphrase we're going to use for this wallet. So it can be whatever you like. And we're just going to use YouTube, all lowercase one word for this video. And then we're going to say OK. We're going to select the same wallet type as before. And we want to encrypt the wallet file. Now, here is our new wallet that is encrypted using a BIP39 passphrase. Now, you'll notice all the transactions before are gone, and all of the addresses we now see when we hit receive are completely different. Now, the other thing that you might have noticed if you're paying attention is it actually only asked you for that passphrase once. It didn't ask you to correctly retype it or anything like that at all. So if you made a typo typing your BIP39 passphrase, you wouldn't actually realize that you'd done that at this point. So what I'm going to do is just to verify that you had indeed typed it correctly, I'd suggest you actually close Electrum, open it again, and by default, it's going to want to reopen the last wallet that it had. So in this case, that was wallet one. We're going to say next. We're going to select the keep key, and it's going to prompt us for the PIN and then the passphrase. So we retype the passphrase, we say OK. And because we encrypted the wallet, if we type it incorrectly, it will open back up. So I'll just quickly show you what it looks like if you were to have a typo in the passphrase. Because we encrypted the wallet, if I were to type in the passphrase with a typo, so let's say YouTube with a capital Y at the front, because it is case sensitive, and then say OK, it'll actually throw this error, which says fail to decrypt using this hardware device. If you use a passphrase, make sure it's correct. So using the encrypt wallet function on Electrum is a good way to make sure that you've got your passphrase right, because again, it's not very forgiving if you have a typo in your passphrase. So when the advisory came out for everyone to use BIP39 passphrases, unfortunately ShapeShift didn't actually support the passphrase, whereas just in the last few days, they actually have enabled that. Though it's that fresh and new that they've still got the warning there saying you disable the BIP39 passphrase. So let's see if it actually works. And yeah, as of mid-December 2019, I've actually just had a look, and even when you log into ShapeShift and enable a BIP39 passphrase, it's actually still generating the same addresses from this earlier wallet that I had before without a BIP39 passphrase. So the issue here is that if, for example, you were using ShapeShift and thinking that you're using your BIP39 passphrase, basically what's happening is you're actually not using your BIP39 passphrase at all. Even though it accepts it without an error message, it's not actually using it. These addresses correspond to a blank passphrase. So what could happen there is if you sent a bunch of crypto to this account thinking that you'd enabled your passphrase and then went to log back in a week or two after they've made it so the passphrase actually works, you'll notice the balance of all of your accounts is zero. So if that happens to you, you'll need to log in with a blank passphrase and then move everything to a new account with the passphrase once they actually get that fixed. The last step in this process is use a third-party wallet. So one that supports things like BIP39 passphrases, because ShapeShift doesn't let you do that. One that allows you to have native SegWit, which again, ShapeShift doesn't let you do things like Litecoin. So you can use lots of other wallets like Electrum for Bitcoin, Electrum LTC for Litecoin, MyEther wallet for Ethereum, or Electron Cash for Bitcoin Cash. There's really no reason why you need to use ShapeShift at all until they improve their user experience a lot. So there you have it. The Keepkey is a really capable device, just let down by, frankly, really terrible software. And fortunately, you don't have to use the stuff they supply. And if you use third-party wallets and third-party tools, you have a really competent wallet. Thanks for watching. I hope that was helpful. Hit like if you think that other people would find this video useful, and hit subscribe if you'd like to be kept in the loop about future content I make that helps people stay safe in the crypto space and to recover if they get into trouble. If you have any questions about this video or a topic that you'd like me to cover, just leave a reply.